kitchen, though. It's in the kitchen, oh, right, right by the window. Remember how they used to put the charge by the window, and I had the box in the right.
Oh, then it might be in Dad's box.
Okay.
Okay, Diane. You want me to let anybody in? Or you want to do it? Because it's 10:56.
That one, I don't do this one. Good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Saw that beautiful video, Joaquin, from you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was really pretty. Good morning.
I gotta figure out how to make it like, it automatically makes it into 15 seconds, but I think there's a way to do it for like longer. So,
oh, okay. Well, that's amazing.
And to change the music, because the music was like not exactly what I was expecting.
Did you do the music, or it just automatically went with it?
It automatically went with it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that was neat. I was thinking, wow, what a production. Already had music to it and everything.
That's what I thought.
That's great. You'll have, well, I was going to say, if you could do it over our backyard, that'd be great to see. How it looks, and maybe we could do that as, you know, you're going to get baptized, and so, but then now,
oh, yeah.
we can't because of the right. No-fly zone. Shucks.
The airport. There's a program that they offer where if I take, like, courses and that kind of prove that I can keep it safe, then I can get license to fly it in those areas.
Oh, okay. Well, tell him. Yeah. He's a good guy. Yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning, Rosie. How you do? I let's see.
I'm my picture's not on because I'm. Okay. I can't, girl.
we know. Don't worry about it. Yeah, just like you said, keep it real. It's all right. It's all good. If I didn't know I had to do what I had to do, I'd be like, oh, no, you don't want to see this.
You look beautiful.
You don't want to see this. Yeah, so good morning.
You look beautiful.
Everyone. Yeah, thank you so much, Rosie.
Good morning to all.
Let's see.
What a blessing, huh, that we saw each other. Hey, how about that? Connie got her car back.
I was just getting ready to text her to let her know. You know what? We prayed yesterday evening, and just about everything, you know, was. I don't know if you read the post, but a few things were missing. But I'm praying that they'll discover those things also.
You know, I had told Joaquin, I just feel in my heart, she's going to get her car back.
Yeah.
And just like minutes later, he says to me, oh, Connie got her car back.
Yeah.
We kept praying.
Yeah.
On our way home. And then, you know, when we got home, when I throughout the night, Lord, reveal it. Now reveal who took it.
And he did, because they were in the car.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So definitely revealed.
Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Yeah. Glory to God.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So was it just some...
I don't know a whole lot about it, but just that little bit, goodness. Like answer to prayer. Yay.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Well, our guest speaker is on board with us already. Dr. Wolf is here, and welcome again to our second service. You look wonderful.
Thank you.
Yeah. So here we go. Hi, how you doing, Bob? Good to see you. And Michael and Sally and Dondi. Hey, Dondi. Hey, brother. All right. Good to see you.
Could Caroline, I just say that I feel so honored and privileged about our guest speaker for today. Oh, my gosh.
It is awesome.
I feel so honored and just like, wow. What a blessing. What a blessing.
You are too kind. You're too kind.
No. I read just a tad and I thought, wow, I would just love to pick your brain, you know, and ask you so many questions. I told my son, our speaker is amazing.
See, your dog says hallelujah to that.
Yeah.
So we're going to give him time.
What were you saying, Lisa?
Oh, I was just going to piggyback on what Rosie said. I'm like, you said to Google him, and I'm like, oh, okay. And then all this information, I could have spent 3 days reading all this stuff. I'm like, holy cow. So really excited and grateful that you are joining us today.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. I'm honored.
Amen.
And good morning, Margie and Peter. Yay, good to see you. Good to see you. My prayers are with you, Margie. I know where you are now. I've been there. So God's strength. God's strength.
Yeah. Well, today I was about 7 o'clock this morning walking through my neighborhood. And in the street, I saw about the size of a postcard. I saw this card, and it said today's prayer. And so, you know, I walked past it, you know, maybe 5 paces, turned around, looked back. Left it there and walked a little farther, you know, because we're so sensitive about making sure that we're sanitary these days. And I didn't want to touch it, but I thought, no, I better go and look. So I went and picked up the card that said today's prayer, turned it over, and it was from 2 Samuel 22. And it said that he is a shield to all of those who find refuge in him. He is a shield to all of those who find refuge in him. So maybe that will prove meaningful to somebody here today. I wanted to pass it along. We're going to, as most of you know, a week ago, we recognized the life of DMX, the rapper who died a week ago Friday. I did make mention of the fact that the following day, Saturday, we saw the departure. As they say in indigenous culture, she went to be with the ancestors of LaDonna Brave Bull Allard. And I don't know if you know much about her, but she died Saturday, and her life means so much to me. I encountered her at Standing Rock, where she was one of the leading elders. And there are so many good things that are happening these days, the raising of the profile of people in the indigenous community. And a lot of it has to do with her hard work. And in a moment, we will recognize her. But first, this.
Bienvenidos al colectivo de Jesus Cristo. Welcome to the Jesus Collective. This is a place where you can rest in the presence of Jesus Christ, where you don't have to be any particular thing, where you can just be who you are. Es un lugar donde puedes descansar en la presencia de Jesús Cristo, donde puedes ser quien eres sin preocuparte de ciertas expectativas. Aquí estamos para apoyarte, para apoyarnos. We're here to support each other. Thank you for being here.
What an automatic blessing to stand where my family comes from. Because I'm Ihunktuwa Pabaska Sisitantokota. My family village is just right down the road. I work for the Tribal Historic Preservation Office. I've spent the last 30 years protecting sacred sites, burial sites, traditional cultural properties, ceremonial sites in North Dakota. I know what's here. And it's really hard for us to ask you, what have we ever done? What have we ever done? I live in my own homeland, in my own country. I am indigenous to this land. The roots go right out of my feet. I have never done anybody ever harm. I have always been good and kind to people. I went to school, I went to college, I bought my own home, I've worked all of my life. What did I do wrong? When you decided to build a pipeline, I thought, I buried my father on this hill so he could have peace, because he asked us to bury him up there where he could see the Kennebunk and the Missouri River. Today, my son lays on top of that hill, next to my father and now my husband. My whole life is buried there, across from this pipeline now. So I must spend every day standing on top of my hill to watch what I know it's coming. I will object until I die on this earth. Dakota Access Expansion, Dakota Access Pipeline. I will not back down. I stand on that hill every day and I watch. That's all I have to say.
Brothers and sisters, this peaceful coexistence with the murder of our people has to stop.
My hands up, but they still show. I can't breathe, get they knees at the no-nos. Your president say he gon' make it how I used to be. Saints been my favorite team, but I can't believe Drew Brees. R.I.P. to Malcolm X, fuck a protest, grab Motex by any means necessary. Cause it been a war, so many that we done buried. Now I see clearly why they won't kill me. Come my skin color and my complexion, they view as a weapon. If I jog through they neighborhood, them bitches just might stretch. Ain't with that pee shit like our ancestors, bitch, we really step. They killed Sandra Bland, took a photo right after her soul ex. What the fuck is they protecting? Till gas is runners over, why a nigga protesting? Used to spray as well, old pipe. Pray for the next generation, I've been through this shit my whole life. Ain't no change yet, still the same shit. Everybody feeling like fuck the law, looting shit, fuck the cause. We need justice, them bitches kill us and try to brush it off. George Floyd, cuffs suffocating, begging for his mother and all. Killed that man on tape with a straight face like it was nothing, dog.
Stop,
stop
falling down.
I'm glad to fall again.
Mama, 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 I love you. Reese, I love you.
You got
hobble. My kids, I love
them. I'm dead.
My hands up, but they still show. I can't breathe, get they knees at the no-nos. Your president say he gon' make it how I used to be. Same thing, my favorite team, but I can't believe Drew Brees. R.I.P. to Malcolm X, fuck a protest, grab Motex by any means necessary. Cause it been a war, so many that we done buried. Now I see clearly why they won't kill me.
Hey, I'm the voice for the ages in the streets. Police killing all of us while we march for peace. Shit is different when you coming from the beach. Cambodian and black Mexican minorities from the east. All they do is shooting niggas with their hands up. And I don't even think they try to understand us. So when you get put over, please don't pick your pants up. Cause they gon' kill you whenever they get the chance, bruh. It's a war outside, I feel like Baghdad. 2020 fucked up, I'm wishing we could backtrack. Unemployment fraud, getting cards or a cash app. COVID make them racist towards Asians, but we can't have that.
My hands up, but they still show. I can't breathe, get they knees at the no-nos. Your president say he gon' make it how I used to be. Saints been my favorite team, but I can't believe Drew Brees. R.I.P. to Malcolm X, fuck a protest, grab Motex by any means necessary. Cause it been a war, so many that we done buried. Now I see clearly why they won't kill me.
Spilled on the street, he was the rose that grew out of the concrete. The same ground where his body lay, like rose petals on a stony grave. Why do we fear each other from the lies of yesterday? I'll never know. Look at all these roses with petals on the ground. They call this one Mike Brown. I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground. They call this one Trayvon Martin. I'm asking you to look at all these roses. Petals on the ground. They call this one Tyshawn Lee. I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground. It's far too many for me. The tears of my mother were spilled at his grave. She knows the cost the whole world could not repay. And when she should have felt our sympathy, all we told her is that her baby was guilty. And do we even have compassion? Do we even wanna see? I'll never know. But look at all these roses. Petals on the ground. called this one Freddie Gray. I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground. They called this one Eric Gardner. I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground. They called this one Sandra Bland. I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground. Every woman, every man. More than a number, would we ever see how beautiful and special and precious you were? Somebody told me that if only you would better decide, you would still be alive. But I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground, like the ones from Sandy Hook. I'm asking you to look at all these roses with petals on the ground, 'cause they will change the story in our history books. So while we can, let's look at all these roses. Look at all these roses. Look at all these roses with petals on the ground. I'm asking you to look at all these roses. Look at all these roses. Look at all these roses with petals on the ground. I'm asking you to look at all these roses. Look at all these roses. Look at all these roses. Was the rose that grew out of the concrete. Till earth and heaven ring.
an objectified God reaches out to all objectified people with compassion and gives dignity, a sense of dignity. Today's voice, we have, as we mentioned earlier, Dr. Miroslav Volf. Question, have you considered inviting friends to your home to join us on Sundays over Zoom? A reminder that we are streaming to our private Facebook group. This Wednesday, Reflections for Earth Day. Earth Day is this coming Thursday. Can you help us help ourselves as we seek to help others? Can you help arrange our presentations, transcribe our services in real time for the hearing impaired, develop a social media presence, build a website, some other way, share a need, share a solution? Our quote is from Chief Arval Looking Horse. Each of us is put here in this time and this place to personally decide the future of humankind. Did you think the Creator would create unnecessary people in a time of such terrible danger? Know that you yourself are essential to this world. Understand both the blessing and the burden of that. You yourself are desperately needed to save the soul of this world. Thank you for helping us do this, everybody. For all of your financial contributions. Well, we saw that. Joaquin, you ready?
I'm here. Told me to pray for repentance, but when God asked them to repent of racism, they told me that wasn't it.
They told me to pray for peace.
When the Spirit led me to give up my guns,
they told me that wasn't it.
They told me to pray for the lost, but when God revealed her nature in them, they told me that wasn't it.
They told me we were all created.
In God's image, but when I called God her, they told me that wasn't it.
They told me to pray for revival, but when revival started, protest streets, they told me that wasn't it.
They told me to stay here.
But when we challenged a president's locker room talk, they told me that wasn't it. They told me to pray for the nations, but when Jesus showed us he wasn't American, they told me that wasn't it.
They told me to worship God.
When I read verses about worship without justice being anathema, they told me that wasn't it.
The dog agrees. Lisa, would you go ahead and lead us in prayer?
Let's talk to our God. Come, let us reason together. Lord, thank you for hearing our prayers. Help me to be a good listener like you are. Help us to grow as a community through love by listening. When I am exposed to hate, help me to promote love in all its truth, kindness, justice, and hope. And in that love, help me to be the greatest conduit of love to all people and all living things. Lord, help me not to settle for fear when I can choose love. In your precious name.
Thank you, Lisa. Well, listen, everybody. We're going to just take a brief moment to warmly welcome one another. And just remember, not everybody is as comfortable as the next person with our breakouts, with our small groups. I know you'll be kind, but be extra sensitive just in case. Welcome back, everybody. Before I introduce our special guest today, let me just say that anybody who has a couple of minutes, maybe 5 minutes after we're all done today, to hang out for a bit of housekeeping, then please do. Don't feel obligated. Miroslav Volf. He's the Henry B. Wright Professor of Theology at Yale Divinity School and the founder and director of the Yale Center for Faith and Culture. He was educated in his native Croatia, in the United States, and Germany, earning doctoral and postdoctoral degrees with highest honors from the University of Tübingen, Germany. He has written or edited more than 20 books, over 100 scholarly articles, and his work has been featured in The Washington Post, Christianity Today, Christian Century, Sojourners, and several other outlets, including NPR's Speaking of Faith, which is now On Being with Krista Tippett, and Public Television's Religion and Ethics Newsweekly. I agree with Krista Tippett, who said Miroslav Volf knows the shadow side of the Christian faith in his personal history, understands what is going wrong when religion turns violent, and why he believes the cure for religious zealotry is not less religion, but more religion, or rather stronger and more intelligent practices of faith. That is the short version of the intro, because I could have used up all of his time. As Rosie alluded to, but it's a joy to have him. The one thing for certain that he and I have in common to some degree is our family's Pentecostal roots, where we experience what it was like to be on the margins of the religious margins in different ways. So it is my honor to present to you Miroslav Volf, everybody.
Thank you, everybody, and thank you especially, David, for inviting me, for letting me be crash your party here. It's a great privilege. And David, just for you, you know, I have membership in the Pentecostal Church back in Croatia and hold ordination.
Me too.
So I haven't been kicked out yet, which means it's good. It's good. So my topic today I want to briefly speak to you about is a fear and hope. And what I'll try to address is the question that I think became so significant for me, not just during this past year or so, pandemic along with political turmoil and signs, indubitable signs of deep racial tensions and so forth, but over the years as well. And that was the question: as we struggle for something better than the kind of home that we inhabit right now, how does one live? Is it possible to live? In what way is it possible to live true life, even in the midst of false life? And one of the central issues is the question of hope. I was talking to my former doctoral supervisor, Jürgen Moltmann, who's one of the most famous theologians of the past century. And he was comparing the situation in 68 in 2018 or further out. And 68 was this time of great hope, great transformation. And 18 ended up being, or even 21, is a year of a kind of more despair, more hopelessness, dystopian moods prevail, if you want. And fear is the signature emotion, maybe anger as well, and not really really hope. We fear and we lash out against our friends or our family. We fear and we exclude others from our communities. We fear and we close the borders to our communities, to our nations. And so this kind of tension between fear and the possibilities of hope is what I want to address. Now, there is a deep connection between the two. And I think probably most clearly was indicated by a very famous Stoic philosopher, Seneca. Stoics were big on hope. Or small on hope, actually, because they wanted to avoid fear. And he said, you will cease to fear if you cease to hope. And basic idea is where hope goes, fear always follows. If you pull out on hope, fear will disappear as well. But it may be for most of us, certainly this for me, a big price to pay in order to get rid of myself or society of fear. Can we hope that the projects we are involved in, struggles that we are part of, can we give up hope that they will succeed? Can I give up hope that my children will do well? Yes, I can concentrate on the present, and it's important to be zeroed in and concentrate on the present, but future is part of us as well. And especially for those of us, for many of us, for the world where it's only in the future that we can find a kind of the fullness of life. So Apostle Paul thought very differently on hope and on fear than Seneca did. And I want to concentrate on Paul and on what he writes in Epistle to Romans. 24 and 25. And he writes there, you remember, this is a chapter and these verses are sandwiched between, on the one hand, description of great trials, on the other hand, of the groaning of the whole creation. And then he writes, for in hope we are saved. Now, hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it in patience. As I mentioned, these lines are found sandwiched between this description of extreme hardship in which he was. He speaks of distress, or not just he, but Christian communities, persecution. He speaks of famine, of nakedness, of peril, of sword. Then there's this line that resonates with many of us today. We are Billy being killed all day long, right? On the other side, as I mentioned, is this kind of sense of this ecological devastation of the nature that's straining under the burden of human sin of humanity. And then in the midst of that, he speaks about hope, of something that is future, that isn't yet, but somehow in a strange way, just by the virtue of hope, already is ours. We cannot see it, and yet it qualifies our entire existence. We're saved, even, he said, by it. It's very similar to kind of experience that many people have when they're in love. Love kind of takes over and defines your entire mood and entire outlook on life, even when the thing that you love or the person you love is not with you. Your entire existence is lived in the light of that relationship. And so it is also with hope. But how do we have hope? How do we recover hope? What is hope? I think it's very important to distinguish hope from a mere optimism. I know we confuse the two, optimism and hope, in our everyday speech, but in Christian vocabulary, the two are very different. Optimism is based basically on the kind of circumstances we are experiencing, what led to them, past that led to them, and what is today. And then we calculate, extrapolate on the basis of what is and what was, what is going to come. And if outlook is good, we are happy. If it's not, we then don't have reason to be optimistic. It's just the hope is very analogous then to expectation. I'm sorry, optimism is very analogous to expectation of good weather, when the weatherman or weatherwoman, on the basis of all calculations, can decide forecast is, it's going to be sunny next day. But that's optimism that relies on circumstances as they are. Hope, the argument is, and my own teachers, whom I mentioned, Jürgen Moltmann, is a great theologian of hope, and that's his basic idea. Hope is not based in Christian thinking, Jewish thinking as well. Hope is not based on circumstances. Whether the weather is going to be bad or not, whether the storm is coming or not, hope can still live, because hope is not based on circumstances, but it's based on the promise. And it's oriented toward this new thing that God has promised. Typical for stance of hope is the stance of Abraham and Sarah, when they were unable to have a child and they were aged and there was just no chance, given circumstances, that they will ever become biological parents. And yet they lived in hope. And this kind of living in that state, hope, which was actually fulfilled, right? And that living in that state, that's the state of hope, based on the promise and based, in fact, on this huge, humongous promise. The mother of all promises at the very end of the Bible, in the book of Revelation, the very end of book of Revelation, where God says, behold, I create all things new. That's the source of the energy that comes to us and that gives us hope. Now, that's what hope is. That's one feature of hope. Now, Paul mentions a feature of hope that we tend completely to disregard. And I have described this as the darkness of hope. Now, let me explain what I mean by this darkness. He writes the following. That's a line from the text that I've read. We hope in what we do not see, right? So obviously you don't hope for what you see. That's a present reality. You hope it's something that you do not see. But what we generally think, I have a clear sense of what I hope for, right? And then it's just a matter that I don't see it in the present reality. I see it in my mind, but I don't see it in reality. And then I hope that that future, which I see clearly, will become the present, my present experience. Now, Martin Luther, who's one of my hero, with a lot of shadow sides to him, but nonetheless, in many regards, very important Christian thinker. He talked about the idea that we actually don't know exactly what it is that we are hoping for. And he bases this idea on further down in the same passage. Apostle Paul writes, we do not know how to pray as we ought. Which is to say, he describes, we do not know how to pray according to the will of God. And, you know, as I was reading this, I thought, well, if one thing is I know is when I am in some kind of trouble, I know how to pray. I just name what needs to happen, Mr. God. And I'm expecting and I'm hoping that that which I have prayed for will happen because I'm praying for the good thing, right? And there's some truth to that as well. But in this passage, and that was Luther's point, is that actually hope, object of hope, is something I do not see clearly. I'm grasping for something that I can't quite recognize yet, and I can't identify fully yet. And you know, this idea, he said, is the hope transfers you into unknown, into the hidden, into the dark shadow, so that he does not even know what he hopes for. Now this is kind of a darkness of hope, but the positive side of that darkness is an openness to surprise, being willing to recognize in what actually sometimes happens the thing that we have without being fully aware of, in fact, being hoping for all along. Now, that sense of not being locked in to exactly what we have looked for, but willing to recognize the contours of the fulfillment, even when it comes in a surprising ways. That's also a feature of hope. And, you know, I describe it always with the feeling that I had when I have fallen in love with my wife. And I remember writing that to her actually, and writing that to her during Advent season. It's like, it's not that I had exact image and picture of who she is going to be. And then if the picture doesn't match, then I'd be disappointed. And if I had this kind of hope for a relationship, those people who have these kinds of hopes for a relationship, they never get to have a relationship because obviously you never find the perfect match to what your expectation. But what you can do is you can discover that somebody, or I have discovered that I have received, when I saw her, I have received, this is what I have actually hoped. It's kind of a realization of what the actual object of my hopes was, and hence fulfillment. So fulfillment, you can put it almost this way, the fulfillment readjusts and enlightens us about what we actually wanted. And you can see that very well also throughout the ministry of Jesus. Disciples are hoping for one thing, and all along we readers, we know that something different than what they hope is going to come. And in the end, their hopes catch up with the reality of fulfillment. That's the darkness of hope, and that's the beauty of surprise that comes out of this darkness of hope. Now, The other feature of hope that Apostle Paul also emphasizes here, and that is patience or endurance associated with hope. Now, we don't like the idea of endurance. We don't like the idea of patience. We've been patient long enough. And in some ways, maybe by simply saying that we don't like endurance, maybe we're saying we actually don't like hope. We like fulfillment, but hope is this in-between state that we want to push against. Now, hope, in one hand, the relationship between hope and endurance and patience is twofold. On the one side, hope supports endurance. I mean, I can't endure in anything if I don't have hope. I can endure in a struggle. I can endure in suffering unless I have a hope for something positive to come after that. We learn endurance only with the help of hope. When hope is lost, endurance turns into passivity and it ends up being simple, kind of staying in the one place, the kind of waiting that has no purpose to it at all, no light to at the end of the tunnel. But on the other hand, endurance supports hope. Now, without endurance, hope becomes a kind of very superficial thing. It evaporates. As soon as the first heat comes, the moisture of hope disappears and it shrivels. The first difficulty comes if hope does not have endurance, hope is itself gone. And, you know, we've all had these times in our lives and known maybe people who are very hopeful very quickly. And then first thing that comes, the hope is gone. Disappointment settles in. Only endurance can preserve hope and then make hope tenacious, sustainable, to help us in our struggles. So let me end with returning back to the idea of fear and hope. Now, why is it that we fear? And I think we often fear because we feel that fear is going to save us. And often fear saves us, right? That's exactly what the fear is designed, a reasonable fear is designed to do. But at the same time, fear often keeps us captive to suffering that has not yet happened, captive to trouble that we anticipate but isn't yet. And in that sense, I think salvation for us lies in hope, so that we are freed from that borrowed trouble in hope. And hope that doesn't insist on the future good exactly in terms that we have imagined, but hope that is ready to rejoice in the kinds of good that actually comes our way. So to say that our salvation lies in hope, I think is to say that it lies in God. It lies in God who promises good things, who creates something out of nothing, who creates something really beautiful out of nothing. Our God is the God who makes dead alive. Our God is the God of the original beginning of all things and the God of all new beginnings. When that God makes a promise, we can hope. And God has made such promise to us, irrevocable promise, in the death and above all resurrection of Jesus Christ. I want to invite you into that kind of hope. Resurrection hope. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Tanya. I'm going to be helping with the discussion, mediate this discussion. But first, I'll just ask a quick question and then we'll go to small group and we'll see what other people are thinking. You talked about praying and how we need to pray appropriately. What thinking about what we're all experiencing right now and how difficult it is to hope, how should we be praying?
I think we should be praying the kind of the way we should be hoping, right? So it's a kind of hope and prayer fit together. And prayer, as Paul says in this text, in accordance to the to the will of God. And so I think a lot of us are involved in a kind of a struggle against obvious patterns of evil that are present in our societies. And we've heard some of that in music at the very beginning of our service. So I think that should be content of our prayers, less about ourselves and more about what we as a community, what we as a world experience. You know, I've come to the persuasion that it's a deep Christian conviction that I cannot fully flourish unless all human beings and all creatures flourish. And all creatures can flourish unless I too flourish. Both of these things belong together. And I think when we pray for the kingdom to come, that's what we're praying for this universal flourishing. Now, what forms the answer to prayer will take? I think that's where it comes to this darkness of hope, so that we don't close the horizons of the answer, but rather recognize, have eyes open to see how answers might be coming our way and rejoice in them.
Okay, so we're going to go to small group now, come back with your questions, and let's continue this discussion.
Blessed in the city, we are blessed in the field. We are blessed when we come and when we go. We cast down every stronghold, sickness and poverty must cease. For the devil is defeated. We are blessed. We are blessed, 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 blessed. We are blessed. Bless, 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 hey, hey, bless, 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 oh, bless, 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 hey, blessed in the city, blessed in the year, blessed when we come and when we go, we cast down every stronghold. And poverty mercy, for the devil is defeated. We are blessed, 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 yeah, blessed, blessed, yeah. Late in the midnight hour, God's gonna turn it around. He's gonna work in your favor. Late in the midnight hour, God's gonna turn it around. It's gonna work in your favor. And around, and around, and around, and around, and around, and around, and around. Late in the midnight hour, God's gonna turn it around. It's gonna work in your favor. Hey, late in the midnight hour, God's gonna turn it around. It's gonna work in your favor. Hey, and around, and around, and around, and around, and around, and around, and around. Hey. Mm-hmm. say we are blessed, blessed. Welcome back, everybody. So any
you know, we were talking about how, you know, we've had so many amazing speakers, and really you know, up until now, I think a lot of the message has been about love, and I mean just everything around love. But I think that today, you know, hope has been so refreshing for us. But I'm just really curious what you're all thinking. I mean, I think, you know, we can all agree that hope is a really hard thing to come by right now. I mean, I was watching the music when we started, and I thought to myself, you know, am I going to see one of those young people of color on the news tomorrow? And they're going to be gone. I mean, it's like, you don't even know. It's just, and so, you know, finding the hope is, so I'm just really curious what you're all thinking and what questions or comments you might have.
I'll just pop in and say that this talk really resonated with me, because I feel like you're expressing a lot of things that I've just sort of done recently, like not wishing for specific things, but just hoping for specific outcomes, and just not accepting that I don't know the path it's going to take. And it's really been a big change in my life. And I just loved what you had to say.
Thank you.
This really worked.
Bob?
Well, thank you so much for this talk. This is a question I think about almost every day, actually. I work in hospice, and so I work with dying people and their families. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you talked about hope and I can't remember exactly how you put it, but you drew a distinction between hope and optimism. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a third thing that happens as well. I have hope in this life that things are going to work out for me to some extent. And I do have those moments of optimism, but there is a kind of immature hope that we have that helps us get through life. And when we come to face our death, that hope must be set aside, and we have to have real hope, you know, hope in the resurrection, which is beyond something that we can see or something that we can, you know, encapsulate, or we can somehow, you know, put into words. And so the question I'm always wrestling with people is, how do we transform, how is our hope transformed from this hope that we experience and optimism into this, you know, eternal hope that we all talk about and we all feel? And I find people so often substitute something at that last moment. And that something is often a religious tradition or ritual, but it's a form of denial, really. That we want, when we face the death of a loved one, we want to deny our own mortality. We can't help it. And so what people will often do is retreat into a tradition that creates a real gap of being between them and their loved one. And I mean, they still love that person, but they put on words and rituals and things that aren't actually taking them to hope. They're taking them to feeling like, I'm going to survive. This is not me who's dying today. I'm going to live tomorrow. And all that happens at a subconscious level. But when you're the outsider and you're trying to be a non-anxious presence, and you do it enough, you begin to see how often this happens with people. And so your words about like the surprising actions of God, that picture you gave us of falling in love was perfect, because it's true. If we knew who we were going to fall in, if we had this exact picture of what we wanted, we would never be successful. There has to be this element of surprise. So what's stirring within me, and really quite powerfully, is how to help people, how to myself live in that place of waiting for the surprise of God. I mean, so thank you.
Yeah, the thing is with hope, I think faith is the same in the same way. It's a kind of a gift for which we can prepare ourselves, but which we cannot simply manufacture. There's no three steps in which you can get to the point that a kind of relinquishment that is important. I think actually that in every genuine hope, there is a hope for resurrection. There's a hope for something that transcends the ordinary circumstances. And it's that kind of hope that kind of pulls us out of being kind of bogged down in a situation, whether that's the situation of a nearing death or any other danger, because fear is a form of always a form of fear of death behind it, right? It depends only how proximate that is for fear of kind of fundamental loss. And how to discover that? I'm not sure. You know, I spent quite, now I can take a long time answering that question, which is really fundamental. But I spent a long time in 2 months, last 2 months, reading Gospel of John. And in Gospel of John, how does one see who Jesus is? He's there in front of everybody, right? 90% of them look at him and don't see. They see the same miracles, they see the same thing. Everything's the same for those who believe and who those who don't. He can persuade them to believe. More he persuades them, the less they want to believe, right? So the kinds of investments that we have, that we made in our lives, they're often in the way of us relinquishing those hopes and translating into something that will return everything that we've relinquished back to us, but in a new form and in a lighter form. And I'll end with this. It's like this idea of this merchant, right? Who sees this incredible wealth hidden underground and then goes and sells everything that he has in order to buy that piece of land. Now, between you seeing that piece of land and being able to sell everything, there is a zone of risk that a lot of us are unwilling to take, right? But those of us who take it are rewarded by that wealth, and everything else that we sold comes back to us, just in a different form. Again, I'm just describing the process, but not describing why you should be motivated or why it's reasonable in order to make that step. And in some ways, it's a non-answer, but that's what needs to happen.
No, it's a very helpful answer, because you really did a great job of what you said at the beginning, putting faith together with hope in that situation. Thank you.
Tanya, did you see Don's hand is up?
I'm sorry, Don, go ahead.
Oh, okay. I was lucky enough to be in the group with him and in the small group. And he started to answer a question that I had. It was a long question I had for him, but it's to get to the second part of my question is, when do you have to start taking action to force your hope, your faith, or your dream to make things happen? Because like in this country here, Black people have been having hope for centuries, been having faith, been having a dream. And I was asking them about Europe. We actually were in Europe around the same time, and how Germany went from all it went through over the last recent 100 years. And he started to answer the question where he was saying that it's actually worse now than it was in the 80s. And I said, in the 80s, it was actually better than it was here as far as racism and stuff like that. And when do you have to start taking action to force your faith, your hope, your dreams?
Yeah. So I would not put I would not think of hope as merely interior attitude and faith as merely interior attitude. I would tie it to practice. Hope is a practice. I know that I have hope when I make concrete steps. And it may be simply, at some points, if in what are described as hopeless situation, it may be simply living in the light of hope that I have, not letting circumstances overwhelm me. But if there's a room for action and movement, I move toward the realization of those hope. The hopes I mentioned in an earlier conversation we had last service, this idea, Karl Marx has this idea that religion is simply hoping for the world to come, right? I hope for the world to come, but it's not simply that. And then he used the term, instead of it being opiate, that kind of makes you passive, that it is a cup of coffee for the present. And so it's almost, it's an upper drug. If you want to use analogies from drugs, it's not a downer, it's an upper. So in that sense, it makes you kind of energetic in the present. And if there's no energy of the present, hope is false. If there's no attempts to change, the hope is false. But what hope gives you, what other kind of, what energy drinks don't, is hope allows you to have also experience of true life in the midst of the false one. And that to me is a really powerful side of things. I mean, what I don't know much about Black churches, but I know that the very good friend of mine, Willie Jennings, speaks often of oppositional joy and oppositional hope. That is to say, hope this in spite of whatever is, this is the life that I claim. And I remember the song we used to sing it. I've got joy that the world did not give me and the world can't take away. Now, what is it that I can have? That's what I want, right? It's not that I want that instead of change. I want that, namely, something that no matter what circumstances come around, cannot be taken away from me. That's true life in the midst of the false and the energy in order to engage in transformation of the of ordinary life and adverse circumstances.
Lisa, did you want to make a comment?
I just wanted, it's so interesting because when I was kind of preparing for worship today, I was reading that part of Esther where it says, you know what? You never know when God's going to put you in a place to be that person for him to do something. And that's what I was thinking. She was like this perfect example of you wait in hope, you wait anticipating for the time when God will put you in a place to activate that hope. And so I love that, so.
I feel like everybody who has commented or asked a question today, we could take your comment, your question, and just like that could have been the only one. And we could have just let Dr. Wolf just kind of, you know, just keep going. One of the things that you said, Miroslav, that you said you were reading John's gospel, and it just so happens I am as well. And you pointed out something that that people were exposed to the same thing, but their responses were very different. Some saw it and some didn't see it. And what I'm noticing is that the people who see are vital to one another. Mm-hmm. We are that cup of coffee in some sense, because the people who don't see, if we spend too much of ourselves, our energy, we will just get exhausted, completely depleted, if we're only around people who don't see. So no matter how much we are around people who don't see, we're going to need to connect with people who see in order to you know, that's our coffee. That's our recharge.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Caroline.
I was going to just following off on your comment. I think that's a big moment where you come to that realization that you can't be sort of hoping for people who are never going to change their minds, who are never going to move on.
Yeah, or you might hope because you believe in God who creates something out of nothing, right? But that won't make, you won't be dependent on realization of that hope, right? What this kind of hope, it lets you live unperturbed by non-fulfillment, right? So pushing for fulfillment, but unperturbed by non-fulfillment. That's the tension that you are allowed to live in. And to me, that's really, if one can achieve that, that's a priceless position to be in. Because it lets you be. It lets you breathe. It lets you live a true life right in the midst of the false one.
Right.
Without saying closing your eyes, without cocooning yourself in, but rather being a point from which energies irradiate outside.
And regarding how to live in unperturbed unfulfillment, Bronda said something in our little group that I thought was helpful, and that is seeing can be a terrible burden. And what do you do with that? So she was saying how leaving it at God's feet, just presenting it to Jesus and leaving it there. It's not like you're turning your back on it or ignoring it, but that's what relieves us of the burden, you know, the burden that's kind of dysfunctional. So I thought that was helpful.
Yeah.
Scott, did you want to add something?
I'm hearing everything people speak. Something struck me, and sometimes I don't feel I even have a right to say this phrase. The arc of history is long, but it bends towards justice. I said that right from Martin Luther King, and I just realized, I've been realizing, so I look at the screen and I see everybody, being a person of privilege by virtue of a race, I'm realizing that there's a sense of justice that I can't get, I can't understand, because I'll put it bluntly, I have three teenage sons and I don't have to worry about them when they're out in the neighborhood because they're white. I'm just wondering, you know, I guess you can see where hope might really be more operative in people who are not being treated justly. And that can go along with other values, because those of us who don't have to worry about that injustice can't see what we're not getting, in a sense.
God bless you, Scott. God bless you. Wow. My oldest son is the most stereotypical looking of my three kids. And I grew up in a household where we were given the talk. And I had to do that with my kids, but especially my oldest boy that I felt.
Rosie, can we see a little bit more of you?
I'm sorry, that I felt because, you know, of how beautiful my baby is, you know, and was when he was just a child, and how he would be targeted. If we would walk into a store and we'd walk in together and he'd be like, can I go and look at the toys? Okay, you can go and look at the toys. We were close enough and he would be followed. So, you know, I had choice words because I just would not, you know, like, why are you, you know, oh. So anyhow, yeah, that's a heavy burden. That is a heavy burden. That's a reality that, you know, we live with here, you know, and I can only imagine everywhere around the world. My youngest son has traveled all over the world. And, you know, with all my prayers, I would give thanks to God that Joaquin has this look about him that's chameleon, almost, you know. He
generic Joaquin.
You know, it's like he, wherever he was, whatever country it was, they embraced him as one of their own, like literally, you know, and glory to God for that, you know, divine protection and favor. I see it as such. I just had to comment on that because Scott, I God bless you, brother. I can't wait until we meet each other in person because your heart, your soul, you have come into that realm of a seer. And I feel like it's through your spiritual eyes, you know, it's like, when he was sharing with us about, you know, when we pray, we don't know what we're praying for, but the Word of God tells us, right? The Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. That's heavy. That's heavy right there. That's hope. It's love. It's intertwined with all of what God is, who he is, and who I feel we are striving to share with each other, with the world, our world, wherever it is that we are. And it's not easy, but at times, I should say for me, you know, because I'll get pissed off quick, fast, and in a hurry, right? You know, but even when that happens, you know, keeping it real, I'm like, Lord, you know my heart. You know my heart. I cannot fake the funk with you. And that is my hope. That is my hope that I hang on to. Oh, I've been near death too many times that I don't know. I kind of feel like, wow, you know, it goes into the purpose, our purpose. I have like so many questions and just like, man, this is heavy.
Thank you, Rosie. Thank you. So many, I know all of you have so many thoughts right now. Anybody willing to share?
I just got to say one thing.
Yes,
Joaquin should have been in movies because he looked like he could have played the Spanish part, the Indian part, the Puerto Rican part, the Native
American. The Turkish part.
I mean,
the Middle Eastern.
Just to comment on that also. I recognize that a lot, though, of what my mom was saying about my older brother, because I'm not perfect and nobody is, but he and I have had similar incidents and run-ins with police. And I can just compare to the way that he was treated and to the way that I was treated. Like I can pass for whatever. Mm-hmm. And even that's kind of a burden psychologically, that, you know, your own brother can have almost an identical experience and get the hard hammer of the law. Mm-hmm. And I can have almost the exact same experience 10 years later and just get a slap on the wrist. Mm-hmm. So
thank you for that. Yes. I mean, I'm thinking about, you know, living in non-fulfillment, and I always want to bring it back to the Jesus Collective. I mean, are we striving to live in our non-fulfillment, but yet trying to balance this with action? And so, and how does that look? Does that make sense?
Yeah. You know, we'll give Miroslav a chance to have the final words in a moment, but we'll have communion after that. But I was just going to, what's been on my mind is that yesterday I was sitting in my backyard, just kind of being still. And I was trying to imagine what we would be once we're all free, once, you know, we're all mixing and that kind of thing. And I didn't come up with anything really specific, but my heart felt very liberated when I just said, "Surprise us, Lord." And so when Miroslav talked about, surprise, being open to surprise, that hope helps us be open to what we want that we don't know what we want. You know, we could go on, but that's okay. Dr. Wolf, we're going to have communion in a moment, but I want you to just kind of distill what you're experiencing with us.
I want to thank you for the opportunity and for your a little snippets of your life stories and of your experiences, and for this conversation. So it's very, very enriching, and it's so good to hear things from variety of life experiences, because we all sit at slightly different places and different angles to the reality. And I think that's also important to keep in mind, and that's why Christian faith isn't a set of unbending rules, but it's about wisdom and about grace. And maybe to pick up simply Tanya's question of unfulfillment and kind of productive unfulfillment, right? So that because if we want to get ourselves into fulfillment before we get to be productive, we'll never get ourselves into fulfillment and never be productive. So it's always this question of in between times. We live in between always, and how to know wisely how to live in between and not be consumed by either dissatisfaction or by apathy. And this is a delicate balance that one needs to play. And each of us will have different kinds of callings and different kinds of journeys to undertake, and balance will look slightly different for each one of us. If somebody is 100% activist, that's going to look different than if somebody is spending most of their time doing some other kinds of tasks and so forth. But I think each of us has that question, and it's a responsibility of discernment, and we are accountable to each other and to our common Lord to do well just in this in-between time, so that he doesn't find us when he comes with our oil burned up and not living actually the light that we ought to live.
Thank you. Dr. Wolf, I just really want to thank you for giving us this very valuable piece of your life and time today. Yeah.
You're most welcome, friends. Thank you for your time and for the opportunity.
Yeah, we're saying thank you.
Thank you.
Communion. We turn to Jesus, a voice from the margins, from the cross even, about as far on the margins as you could get with regard to official power. And we find Jesus in all people who have been pushed aside and pushed down. When we have communion, we're saying, we listen to you. And in you is the resonance of hope because of resurrection. And so we call upon the power, the spirit of resurrection, to come and flood our lives. Whether they seem to be productive or not, we will be productive in our unfulfillment. We accept our unfulfillment as long as it lasts, because hope sustains us. This is the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Would you eat and drink? Well, this brings our time together to a close. And anybody have just a couple of extra minutes, hang around after this. Wow. So, everybody doing okay? I really feel like I could have watched Bob go back and forth with Miroslav with this idea of being close to mortality and death and
all day long.
having to transfer hope. I you know, that could have been a tennis match. So I just wanted to observe that we're doing well, we're doing okay financially, and you know, we took this leap some months ago, but with real confidence and hope. I just wanted to say that in case it was on somebody's mind, because, you know, I'm not getting my Church for the Nations, support that we once had. But, you know, one of the reasons it works out so well now is that we don't have the overhead. We're not paying for a building, all the insurances and security and personnel and, you know, whether it's maintenance or office, a lot of overhead is gone. Most of our overhead is in equipment. And the biggest thing is our guest speakers. We give our guest speakers $500 and Miroslav Volf, when I first invited him some 6 months ago, he wanted $1,000 for his appearance. And then he texted me this morning and said, don't pay me. So just wanted you to know that things are working out. Yeah.
Wow.
So any thoughts, any questions? I mean, that's all I had, but I didn't want to say that with him around.
Well, we talked about maybe possibly getting together in early June. So I don't know, that wasn't on our announcements, but
that's right. That's right. Glad you brought that up. June 5th.
So we're penciling it in.
Was it 5th or 3rd?
Oh, 5th? I could be
it was
wrong.
Saturday. It was Saturday. So.
Whatever the Saturday is.
Yeah. Okay. I want to say it was the 5th.
I was just saying that Ernie's birthday is the 3rd. That's what I was saying.
Oh, that's what it is. Yeah.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh, well, there's a lot of June bugs, huh?
I was looking around. We were talking about how we might want to select a park that is allows us to reserve a time so that we know we have a space with tables.
Especially for people who are driving from Santa Maria.
Yeah. So I'm looking around. I'm looking around to see what I can find because I know some up here, you know, the group places are still closed. But I'm looking around, so I'll keep looking on
that. What about Cathedral Oaks?
Who?
Cathedral Oaks?
Oh, in
Santa
here,
Barbara?
Yeah, Tucker's Grove. Mm-hmm.
Oh, Tucker's
Grove. That's what it's called.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's on Cathedral Hoax.
Is that in Ventura?
It's in Goleta.
It's in Goleta.
Right on the border. Goleta, Santa Barbara. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Tucker's Oaks.
Tucker's Grove.
Grove. Okay. And they have space for with lots of tables and stuff.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, they do.
Can we reserve, or would that just be something?
It is, yeah, it can be reserved. Yeah, at last
okay,
I'll
look into that. Yeah, I'll look into that then.
But Tucker's Grove, Ellie's. Do you make reservations?
Oh, Ellie's Park.
Yes,
nice.
Reservations.
I think we can see that.
And in the women's group, we just kind of threw it out there though that maybe everybody could just bring your own lunch, your sack lunch, or bag.
Yes, I think that's a great idea.
And then we can just have more time to fellowship, you know.
Yeah, that's a nice idea.
And we could have a couple of pizzas delivered, huh?
There you go.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Of course, yeah.
Or but pick them up from Costco.
I heard Sister Diane was supposed to bring all the cakes, though.
Yes, I'll be bringing all the cakes. I'll stop by Costco and pick them all up.
I think it was Peter who said, we want to go somewhere where they have drinks. Well, they don't have them at the park, but we can bring our own if we...
There you go.
I had a quick question about... Has anybody heard from Gary?
Okay,
about
Gary? Party,
oh, I'm glad you brought Gary up. All right, so Diane and I heard from... Shella. Shella, you... Go ahead, Shella.
Go ahead, Pastor Moore. Go ahead.
But you're the one
we
who...
We want to see you.
Okay, so right. Yeah, go ahead.
So we did hear from Deborah. I heard from her about 10:30 last night, and she is just, I guess, well, she's visiting her husband and not staying there with him all the time, but he is not walking as well. And the doctor wants to keep him there for a while longer, so his therapy won't start until later, like maybe a week or so later. But she and Gary are just over the top with all the love, the cards and the thoughts and the everything that people are sending. They're over the top and I'm so grateful for that. She's so grateful. I did send her Pastor Diane and David's numbers so she can contact them as well. But they're just over the top. So we're just continuing to pray for Gary to be able to walk again and be healthy and strong. That's the hope.
Praise God.
I'm glad to hear that because I have Gary's number and I've left a voicemail, but I didn't want to keep doing that because then, you know, you fill up a mailbox and all that kind of thing. So
yeah.
And let's pray that Gary will be patient with himself, because I know after being, you know, in physical therapy and it doesn't happen all at once, you can get discouraged. But it's going to happen, though, with time.
In Jesus' name.
So he will let his body just do its perfect work in time.
Yes. Pray for his hope.
So we had a visitor yesterday. We had Rosie and Big Easy and Hasmeen and Joaquin came by to see us. It was a drive-by, wonderful visit.
Beautiful.
Such a blessing.
Blessing. Blessing indeed.
Yay, yeah.
So now we can certify that they actually exist physically.
We saw their bodies. Their beautiful bodies.
Such a blessing.
Mm. Well, everybody have...
And your haircut looks very nice.
What was that?
And your haircut looks very nice.
I got my first haircut in a year. Okay, don't get too excited about it. But... Yeah, I got about two. You wouldn't believe. I mean, yeah, it was about, this is about a third of what was there.
Beautiful.
I guess if I take Don's advice, I should start acting.
I can see there?
Roles for everything.
¿Por qué no? Phyllis's That's daughter is returning to work in a week. Wow. Cool.
Yeah, she had two hip replacements and she's already returning to work next week.
Wow.
Wow, that's wonderful. Woo.
Yeah, we're stoked.
Now that's Nevaeh's mom?
Yes.
Okay.
Nevaeh and Andriana and Adrian and David.
Just a few.
Yeah.
Who's that in your background?
Oh, that's my family. I went and visit my mom.
Okay.
Yeah, you just got back about a week and a half ago, right?
Yeah, I went for Easter. Was her birthday. She turned 85.
Oh,
and I hadn't seen my brothers or my sister in and my mom in 15 years.
Wow.
So we had a good time. We had a good visit.
Yeah, the country, the land looks beautiful.
Oh yeah, that's up north where my mom lives. She lives in Lewiston, Michigan.
That's beautiful.
We got to go over the bridge up to the Upper Peninsula. It's kind of cold, but there was no snow. There was no snow. I was surprised.
So you did you have the right wardrobe for... To travel back?
Yeah, kind of. I don't have a winter coat. I just wore my hoodie over there. It wasn't really that. It was like 36 to 40 every day. It's not that cold. I mean, we get that here at night, so.
Okay. That's good.
Scott, where do you live?
I think it's Santa Maria area.
You're muted.
Orca.
I taught a course in Zoom for a local college, and I can't tell you how many times I had the mute on. I think the students liked it. But I live right Santa Maria, but right on the verge of I'm an orchid, very close to Tanya.
Okay, yeah.
Melita is easy to get to.
Right, from orchid especially. Yeah,
very easy. So, and I'd be thrilled to meet everybody.
Well, maybe over the next couple of weeks, we can take a vote and see.
Lisa, what were you going to say, Lisa?
Oh, I was going to start just a rambling off thought. If we had a possible idea for somebody to guest speak, should we just email it to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We are a collective.
I just want to say again how much I enjoyed today's speaker. I
Wow, I really wish I could, you know, like ask him questions about how he feels regarding and this is, you know what, actually for all of y'all. How do you feel about all roads lead to God?
You know, it's interesting you would ask that. And of course, I should say that, remember, he has about 20 books, but I have one. Hold on.
He's going to the Moore Library.
I see.
We have a million books.
Okay, Diane must have moved it. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, I probably did. No. Which one is it?
That's okay. He wrote a book called Allah, and it explores, the borders or lack thereof of the Christian God and the Muslim God. And so that's just one thing that he's written. I mean, he's written so many books.
Another possible surprise by God.
Right. It's interesting that Rosie would raise that question, though, huh?
I wish we could take his class, one of his classes.
Right. Right.
That'd be cool. You know, the other question is, and I get this a lot, you know, from different people who will say, but I'm a good person. I'm a good person, you know, so why should I have to ask Jesus into my heart? Why? You know, if I do good, you know, why should that not be good enough, right? Okay. I'm going to look it up.
Here's a blurb. Yeah. A clash of gods is a clash of ultimate values. That's why whether or not a given community worships the same God as does another community has always been a crucial cultural and political question and not just a theological one.
Mm-hmm. Well, Rosie, I want to say one thing. Once when I was working in a rehab clinic, I was with a man who was Muslim, and he was just in a lot of pain. And, you know, because of the relationship we had, I just said, can we just pray together? And when I called him brother, I mean, he started weeping. I started mm-hmm. weeping too. But anyway, I just want to say, I just kind of feel like, you know, I don't know. I just want to say, I know that there's other things, but I just kind of feel like love is very, very, very important. And it's the name of God. So I just,
yes,
I just felt God's love in the room.
Yeah. That's beautiful.
Yesterday, for a little bit, mask and everything distanced, I got to spend an hour with my friend Jojo, who I remember last year sometime we were having lunch, and I asked him about his fellowship, and he said, kind of reluctantly, I'm a Muslim. And I just had a spontaneous expression of joy, and from that moment on, it was a new relationship. We are relaxed. Yesterday we laughed about how much alike we are. Yeah. Mm. It's wonderful.
Yeah. And you know, Rosie, you asked, do all roads lead to God? And have you ever had the experience of talking with someone who doesn't proclaim to even be on a road, or they're on a different road, and
right.
you're talking with them and suddenly you see Jesus in their face, or the Holy Spirit speaks through them?
And I think the question, or the thing that doesn't dawn on us sometimes, is if Scripture says that God is only for Jesus, let's not forget who Jesus is. Jesus is God. That's kind of the way.
What if instead of the roads leading to God, what if the roads come from God?
There you go.
I just want to say I'm so grateful for all of you guys, and I'm so grateful that we can come together. I can't wait till we can meet together on June 5th. So anyway, I love what you said, Pastor David, about that we do need each other. Because hanging around too many people who aren't seeing what I feel like God's showing me, it does make your hope start dwindling and dying. So my hope has been encouraged every time we meet on Sunday. So God bless you guys.
God bless you.
Love you. Oh, Margie, now, how long is this series going on Thursdays?
Till June 15th, mid-June.
Okay.
9 more weeks.
The reason I ask is we are having a conversation with some of our Anabaptist friends, Matt Lowe, I think you know Matt, and then Tim Nafziger, who's with the Bartimaeus. Oh, you know Tim from Surge. We're talking about having a series of workshops on defunding the police in the Anabaptist tradition. And Sue Park Herr helped develop the curriculum for that. And they're going to make it available at no charge. And so I was thinking that, because Matt has offered to facilitate that, I was thinking that we could meet on Thursdays when New Covenant meets, and just have that for, I think it's six Thursdays or 6 weeks if we decided to do it another time. But I think that that's such a hot topic these days. It's such an important question, and we would want to know if this is a viable alternative. You know, how does this mesh with the message of Jesus? So, something to think about. No dates have been set.
Tim was on today. Did you see that, Pastor?
Yes.
Yeah.
Talking about possibly having that on Thursday after the Love Required of Us is over?
Yeah, down the road.
Okay.
I mean, it's almost June. Already it's almost June.
I know, huh? Bob, I would definitely like to go to that.
Bob, is that okay with your Thursday schedules? Yeah.
I would like that because I feel like maybe it might give us some ideas for action.
Right.
You know?
Yes.
I feel like, I mean, I'm learning, I'm taking in things, but I am itching to do something.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And way too much talk about the police needing more training, you know? More of the same.
One of the
What would the time be for that on Thursdays?
At 7 p.m.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
One of the beautiful things, Margie, about Surge, yet as you know, is on the Surge group website, every day there's possible actions posted. When COVID's gone, in fact, maybe before COVID's gone, but we're really looking forward to a fulfillment of being physically in some of those.
I'm in. I'm going to put in chat for those of us who are still here a remarkable website that Sayuri Yoshida discovered. And It documents a lot of Asian life in America, but especially anti-Asian anger and assaults and murders and things like that. It's a bigger deal than I think society is letting us know, that media are letting us know, because it is. And you know, they try to be unbiased. I mean, they bring up stuff that Asians, you know, missteps by Asians. But, you know, the big one right now is the FedEx shooting included 4 or 6. And they're seeing that as a possible hate crime, you know. Apparently, 95% of the employees at that particular FedEx facility are of Indian descent.
Hasmin was just saying there was another shooting this morning in Texas.
One in Kenosha also.
What?
Yeah. Kenosha last night.
And
this is our country before COVID too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
This is what we mean when we say we don't want to go back to normal.
Right.
Normal isn't.
I was thinking of that with the crash shoots. I was thinking of that poem, No Man Is an Island, and then thought of how we are all affected by the losses. Every person is something that's been taken from me. And just that whole idea of our community. It's so hard to, I guess, to process what the loss really is for us, because it's so great. I just need to say something about it, and I don't even know what I want to say.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned that. It's as though we're not just living with post-traumatic stress. We're living with present traumatic stress disorder.
Yeah.
And perhaps pre-traumatic distress.
That is so true, Pastor, and important to speak about, especially for those individuals who have little children. It just affects so much, that stress level causes that stress to just permeate through everything down to these little children that, like, I see it, for example, with my little neighbor babies. The older one especially, but